Welcome to Life Devotions, and thank you for joining me today. You Don't Know Me is the title of this devotion. And I know many of you who watch me regularly on these devotions, you kind of go, oh yeah, I know you're Robert Mosbach. Yeah, I'm actually not talking about you happening to know my name and my features and all of that, and you could recognize me and say, oh, I know who that guy is, that's Robert Mosbach. I'm not talking about that kind of knowing. You know, they knew Jesus when he came to Nazareth after he had been baptized by John in the Jordan, and the Holy Spirit descended from heaven and remained upon him in the form of a dove, and the voice was heard from heaven saying, "You're my son, and you are well pleased." He came to Nazareth not too long after that, and they said, "Is this not the son of Joseph? And do we not know his brothers and his sisters?" And they were offended with him. They were offended. And they actually tried to murder him by throwing him off the cliff. And if you've ever been in Nazareth and I've been there physically, you watch that cliff. I mean, it is exceedingly steep and rocky. So he would have, without question, physically died there. But the Lord's time had not yet come, and he walked out from among them and marveled that their unbelief was so forceful that he was not allowed to do any great works there, except that he laid hands on a few and healed them. But you know, dear friends, because he wasn't recognized for who he was, they did not know him. And I hope you're starting to see what I'm talking about. They did not know him, the Son of God. You are my son and you are well pleased. They didn't know him. They knew him as son of Joseph and Mary, but they didn't know him as the Son of God. And how many only know people after their natural nature? Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, "I know no one after the flesh, for I know that anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old is passed away. Behold, everything has become new." And the Apostle Paul understood what we're talking about here today. And it says here in John, the Gospel of John chapter 1 verse 10, "He," Jesus, "was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him." Here comes the creator of heaven and earth, and everybody can see him in flesh and blood and hear him speaking to them, but they did not know that he was the creator. They did not know him. And he came to his own, verse 11, and his own did not receive him. He came to the Jewish people and they didn't receive him. I mean, they were the people worshiping him, yes, and studying his scriptures, but they did not receive him. Look what he says in John chapter 5 to his own, right? It makes the point here. He said, "There is another," verse 32, "who bears witness of me, and I know the witness he witnesses of me is true." It's the Father who bears witness of me, yes? The Father himself who bears witness of me. And the very works I do bear witness that he has sent me. Verse 37, "The Father himself who sent me has testified of me, but you have neither heard his voice at any time nor seen his form. You do not have his word abiding in you, because whom he sent him you do not believe." Listen now, he's not talking about people that have absolutely no regard for God, never know his scriptures and never pray or never go to church or so to speak or anything. No, he's talking about people that are religious, that study the scriptures and all that. And he says, "You do not have his word abiding in you. For he says, you search the scriptures," verse 39, "for in them you think you have eternal life, but these are they which testify of me, but you are not willing to come to me that you may have life. I do not receive honor from men, but I know you, that you do not have the love of God in you. I have come representing my Father, in my Father's name, but you do not receive me. If another comes representing himself or in his own name, him you will receive. How can you believe who receive honor from one another and do not seek the honor that comes from the only God?" You see, when you truly, honestly long to see God glorified, then He begins to enable you to know Him, to recognize Him, to perceive Him. And He may come through a child, through a woman, through a man, old, young. He may come through, I'll give you a little example, okay? When I came to Folkestone in 1988 to have a Jesus Now crusade at the Leascliffe Hall, I went to go visit all the local pastors. You know, I got a list of their names and addresses, and I went to go see them. And I went and go see this man in the part of town here called Cheriton in Park Lane, and his name, the Pentecostal Church. How silly, his name was there in my mind a moment, it'll come back to me in a second. So I went to go see this pastor, and he was quite old already at that time. And he was kind to me. He was kind to me. He said, "Robert, I don't think I can get involved with what you're doing, but I do see there's something about you." And he was kind to me, I'll never forget it. So then we're talking, oh, how many years later? 20 plus years, maybe 25 years. I would guess more than 25 years later, I get a phone call from his dear wife. And no, excuse me, somebody said to me, "Do you know that that pastor is about to pass away and he's at the hospital here?" I thought, wow, I should go see him because he was kind to me when I came here so long ago. So I went to the hospital. There was this old gentleman, and he was Harold Young. There's his name. I knew it was in there. Harold Young. And he was there, an old man, and he was almost gone to heaven. He almost left his body. His body was completely shutting down, and there was no more communicating from his body in any form or fashion. He was growing cold and starting to get a bit blue. You could see, okay, he's about gone. And Jean, his wife, was standing there, and I said, "Hi, Jean." She said, "Oh, thank you, Pastor Robert, for coming. I'm just waiting. He's almost gone." And I looked at him, and I thought in my heart, I'll never forget it, "Lord, what can I say?" And the scripture came up in my heart from Jude, verse 23 or 21 or so. "The Lord is able," and before I could finish, he started, "to keep me from falling and present me without fault in the presence of his glory." He finished the scripture for me. And he looked at me with bright light in his blue eyes. He said, "Wow, Pastor Robert, how kind of you to come and see me before I go be with the Lord." You see, I knew him. Not after the flesh that was almost dead and passed away. No, in the spirit. And he woke up spiritually. The Bible says, by the Spirit in Romans 8, we receive life into our mortal flesh. And that mortal flesh came alive with its faculties. Jean had tears in her eyes because she saw the resurrection life, because that body had no more ability to communicate, to know, to perceive. You know, it was like fully asleep. That's what death in the flesh is likened in the Bible, sleep. But praise the Lord, even though we fall asleep in the flesh, we wake up in the presence of the Lord instantly. We'll never taste death. That is God's promise in Christ. Read it in John chapter 11. And so I said, "Wow, how kind of you." He said, "How kind of you to come and see me." I said, "Wow, Pastor Harold, would you pray for me before you go to be with the Lord?" And he laid that cold hand upon me, and the blessing of the Lord came through that mortal flesh that was almost completely finished. You see, I knew him, but not after the natural man. For him to be able to remember me so clearly and speak so clearly, that was the life of the Lord. Paul says, not that we might know God, but that we might be known of God in Galatians. And then he says to Timothy, "Timothy, this is the sure and unshakable foundation of God. God knows his own." Jesus lived in the Father's knowledge. In Matthew chapter 11, Look at that with me, verse 27, Matthew 11. Oh my, I love this part. I really do, and I wish I could, because this is where he says, learn of me that I'm meek and gentle and lowly of heart, you'll find rest for your soul. But he says here in verse 27, all things have been delivered to me by my Father. In other words, the Father has entrusted all of himself to me. He has entrusted all of himself to me. Oh, I love that thought. And no one knows the Son except the Father. Nor does anyone know the Father except the Son and the one to whom the Son wills to reveal him. No one knows me. Why am I saying this to you? Because many times we struggle with wanting to be known, recognized, appreciated. And we could struggle with identity. And sometimes you may be looking for an identity. You're trying out different kinds of way of clothing. You watch different things on YouTube or whatever you call these platforms. And you see a certain identity. You go, wow, that's cool. And you try to be like that. And you're trying to find your identity. And while all of these things can in some ways be innocent and sometimes not as innocent, you've not been called to emanate, to emanate these images that you see. No, the Heavenly Father predestined you to be conformed to His image. You're to be like your Father. Jesus said, no one knows me, but my Father knows me. He looks at the people that worship God and He says, you don't know me. He looked at the world He created and He said, you don't know me. You see, this is the wonderful gift of God to help you find who you really are. Jesus said in Matthew chapter 16, He said to His disciples, who do you say that I, the Son of Man, am? And Peter said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus said, blessed are you, son of Barjona, for no one has revealed this to you but my Father who is in heaven. And upon this rock, what rock? Of the Father revealing who Jesus is. Jesus is the rock of our salvation. He builds His church. It's the Heavenly Father who reveals in you that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and that you've been called to be conformed to His image, take on His character and His nature. And the more you become like Jesus, the more you discovered what you were predestined to be. As both male and female, you were predestined, read it in Genesis 1:26, to be conformed to the image of your Father. And Jesus is the perfect image of the Father. And you are called to be like Him. And this is the wonder of God coming to know you and you coming to know Him. Let me close with this thought. While this Peter said in Matthew 16, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. In John chapter 6, when Jesus saw everybody leaving, He said to His disciples, do you want to leave me too? And Peter says, where shall we go? You have the words of eternal life, and we've come to know and believe that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. And Jesus looked at Peter and the disciples with Him, and He said, have I not chosen you? And you are chosen of God because you know Jesus is the Son of God. But I want you to see something. In Luke 22, Jesus said, Peter, I've been praying for you because Satan has repeatedly asked to sift you like wheat. But I prayed your faith won't fail. And after you've returned to me, strengthen your brethren. Peter said, Lord, I would never leave you. Let's go there for a moment. I need to read you something. Peter said, no, Lord, never. Here, look. But he said to him, Lord, I am ready to go with you both to prison and to death. Verse 34, he said, I tell you, Peter, the rooster shall not crow this day before you will deny three times that you know me. You see, that is the work of Satan. Where the devil will look at you and say, well, who are you? You're nobody, you're nothing. Why, if you were something, why don't you heal that person? If you were something, why don't you have this? If you were truly a child of God, how come this has all gone wrong in your life? How come this has happened? How come that's happened? You see, that's the nature of Satan. That is the nature of Satan. He's so evil. And Jesus said, Peter, Satan is asking to prove that you are like chaff, you're worthless. Chaff is what is separated from the grain and is blown away by the wind. It's the shell of the grain. It's a little shell. He sought to sift you like wheat. He sought to prove, Peter, that your faith is worthless, but I know your faith is the true grain of God's word living. My Father has revealed in you that I am the Christ. I know that you have his knowing. I know you have his knowing, Peter. And I know your faith won't fail because it's the true seed of God. And Peter didn't at that moment realize that the forces that were coming against him were stronger than him without Christ. That's only through Christ that we can overcome these forces. When the devil comes against you and says, you know, if you were such a good Christian, why did you blow it there? Hey, if you were a child of God, then how come this has gone wrong? How come that's gone wrong? You know, that is the nature of Satan, to create doubt and question in your heart. And I want you to see here, in closing, about Peter, starting at verse 31, and a little bit here. Verse 54 of chapter 22. Having arrested Jesus, they led him and brought him to the high priest's house, but Peter followed at a distance. Now when they had kindled a fire in the midst of the courtyard and sat down together, Peter sat among them, and a certain servant girl, seeing him as he sat by the fire, looked intently at him and said, this man was also with him. But he denied him, saying, woman, I do not know him. And after a little while, another saw him and said, you also are of them. But Peter said, man, I'm not. And after about an hour had passed, another confidently confirmed, saying, surely this fellow also was with him, for he is a Galilean. And Peter said, man, I do not know what you're saying. Immediately while he was still speaking, the rooster crowed, and the Lord turned and looked at Peter. And Peter remembered the word of the Lord, and he said to him, before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times. And Peter went out and wept bitterly. So let me close this devotion here with this thought. Maybe you have wept bitterly. What am I, Lord? What am I? What do I have? What can I do? Maybe you've looked in the mirror and you say, Lord, I'm this, I'm that. I'm not tall, I'm not slim, or I'm too slim, or I'm too big, too fat. Whatever, you know, or you've said, I don't have the education, I don't have the money, or Lord, you know, what is it that maybe has made you feel inferior, that's made you feel, I'm nobody, I'm nothing? Maybe you've suffered painful rejection. What's the answer? Why don't you offer all those tears to the Lord and say, Lord, I have no one in heaven that I long for but you, and there's nobody on earth but you that can save me. I'm yours, Lord. And I guarantee you will find yourself in Christ and Christ in you, and he will calm all these pains and hurts and bring you to rest in the knowledge of himself, that you are the beloved child of God, highly valued, and that God is proud to be called your Father and to take care of you and prosper you. And he can take those who are lowly and despised by men and make them an example of his grace and love. And that's what he's doing for you. Have a good day.